From Screen Junkies Studios in the heart of Los Angeles, this is Screen Junkies Movie Fights. Now your host, Andy Signor.
Hello, Screen Junkies. Welcome to another episode of Movie Fights. I'm so excited to have some amazing fighters here. This is going to be a good one. Today we have some awesome arguments. It's going to be who should play Robin in a future Batman movie, best Johnny Depp performance, which Disney animated movie could join a live-action Disney universe. It's going to be a very fun time, so stay tuned. As always, if you don't like something we're fighting about, click on the bottom right-hand corner, pick your fight, and you can zoom ahead or go back and forth, rewind, fast forward, and see all the stuff that we're going to do and handle today. So, I'm very excited. I'm bringing this man back. I love this man. He is a movie encyclopedia just in his brain. I don't know how you do it, but everything gets pulled out. He's the man of Access Hollywood, co-host of Profiles. It's Scott Mance, a.k.a. Yes. Movie Mance. Welcome back.
Yay. Thanks so much for having me. I love Screen Junkies. I love movie fights. This is the place to be. I wouldn't miss this for the world. Welcome, folks.
And you recently had your first win on the Nick Mundy run
Mundy
episode.
Fights.
On Monday Fights. And I got to say, I don't agree with all of his verdicts, but at the end of the day, I tallied the same vote he did.
I just want to say about that again. How do I lose a Star Trek argument?
That made no sense. They had tacos.
Tacos.
That was silly. But there was a couple. Yeah, that one you won. Anyway, doesn't matter. That one holds true. I hold it. I say that's a legit ruling, and good job on that. Next to him, we're so excited to have him back. Host of Cast of Characters in the Top 10 podcast is John Rocha.
Hi.
Woo-hoo, thanks John. For having me back.
John, you were on the episode with my dad. Wasn't that fun?
It was a blast.
And you were so respectful, so thank you.
Of course, it's in my nature.
But I remember that being a very fun episode, and I'm glad to finally have you back. How are you doing?
Thank you. I'm doing great. I'm looking forward to it. Mance, I mean, it's just everything there is.
It's a good competition. Next to both of them, making her debut on the show, I'm very excited. She's the creator and host of Nerd Alert. It's Kim Horcher.
Yay. Hey, Kim.
Woohoo!
I'm sorry, I cheered myself.
Oh, go for it. I mean, that's where you got to do it once in a while. Kim, welcome. Are you excited to be here?
Yeah. I can't meet your energy, but we'll try.
Yes. Well,
if
I could sell it, I wouldn't need to work for a living.
You can. It's amazing, that energy. As always, on the Dan Cam, it's Mr. Dan Merle.
Yeah, Dan.
Yay.
Hi.
How are things, Dan?
They're good.
We just had the streamies last night.
Yeah.
We partied a little bit. And we're up recording early, so we're trying our best to truck through. We're going to do it for you guys.
Mance is giving us enough energy for all of us. I'm feeding off of Mance's energy.
Next to you, Dan, I got to introduce this fellow. It's Chris Zimmerman, guys. Chris is on the fan cam for us. Chris has this amazing podcast, The Magnificent Seven. And you, Dan, you've been on the show, correct?
I have. I've been on the show a couple times. I think, who else has been on?
Spencer?
Mundy.
Spencer. JTE.
And soon me, yes?
Yeah. Soon you.
Oh, man.
Alicia Malone.
Make it official.
And Chris brought me a gift. This is so cool. He brought me my favorite movie, Jaws.
Yes.
On Laserdisc.
Wow.
So this is going up in my house.
Wow.
Look at that. Thank you, Chris.
Chris, where are you from? You're in for the week here. Where are you from?
Phoenix.
Well, welcome to L.A. We were happy to have you here. It's on the fan cam.
Happy to be here.
We're going to start bringing you fans once in a while when you're in town or fans we know. We want you to be involved and watch and get involved. So, Chris, are you excited? Are you ready to do this?
I'm very excited.
I may call to you to help at certain points, so get ready. And welcome to the show, and thanks for your support. All right, guys, rule reminder, as you all know, I'm basing these arguments. It's about the argument on your facts, your passion, your creativity. It's not what I want, no matter what the internet tells me that I do. It's not what I want. I'm listening to what your arguments, and I do have reasons behind it always, which are your points that you're making. Any questions before we begin? Good. Let's do this.
Let's rock and roll.
Let's do it.
This is where we fight.
Fight.
Round one. It's been rumored that Warner Brothers will be making 3 standalone Batman movies after Batman versus Superman. They're going heavy on Batman. They liked Ben Affleck. They like what they saw, according to all the rumors, and they're tripling down. So there's also a rumor that the death of Robin could be a major plot point in those movies as well. So Dan Claro, at Claro Dan on Twitter, asked us, who should play Robin in a future Batman movie? I think it's a fun question. It's an important character. It's been played sillily and well. And I guess Chris O'Donnell, really, probably the most recent popular one. Sort of Joseph Gordon-Levitt. Who should be Robin in a future Batman movie? And Scott, we're starting with you.
Okay, I'm going to say Ellen Page should be Robin. First of all, I think it would be great to have a woman play Robin. It's been done in the comics. You had it twice with Stephanie Brown and Carrie Kelly. Why not bring it to the big screen? And Ellen Page has serious superhero movie cred because of Kitty Pryde from X-Men The Last Stand and a little bit in X-Men Days of Future Past. She was also in the very underrated and little seen but very effective superhero spoof called Super. And the great thing about Ellen Page, first of all, she is an Oscar nominee. She is feisty. She is fun. She doesn't take anything from anyone. And if anybody can stand up to Batman as Robin, it is Ellen Page. There's my argument.
Good starter. We're going to start next with John. What's your pick?
All right, my pick is Taron Egerton from The Kingsman. He's young enough to still do it, especially if you're going in a trilogy. He's still new to the world consciousness as an actor. And he's not so well known yet, just so the Robin role could really launch him into the stratosphere. It's a chance to show us his dramatic chops, what he can do with it, and how far he can go. And I think we've seen how just the beginnings of how good of an actor he is and how far he can take it. And I think that's what's important here for this if you're starting out. And I think he held his own with Colin Firth. He held his own with everyone else who was in Kingsman. So why wouldn't he hold his own with Ben Affleck? That wouldn't be an issue. And Ellen Page is a nice choice. However, Ellen Page, I think she's transcended playing second banana to anybody. And I think she already did it in Super. We saw what she could do. She's great in that. But I think I think Robin is a little bit below her at this point. I think she should lead a film as a superhero. I think she should be the one that's the point person. And with Taron Egerton, he's still building his cred. He's still young. And I think he's got a lot of time. And I think this would be the perfect role for him to really blow him up.
Kim, let's hear what you got for Robin.
I want Nicholas Hoult to be Robin. I think he's right about the right time in his life where he could be Dick Grayson and then grow into the Nightwing role eventually if this becomes a trilogy, as you said. We've seen him in Mad Max Fury Road. He was incredible as Nux. And then when he also has a strong superhero background as Hank McCoy, and he brought a very nuanced play to that role where he was a smart man, but he's also making some not great decisions, and he was in Warm Bodies, which I liked.
Warm Bodies is good.
He can be funny. He can bring the grace and charm.
Great. All right. Let's fight.
Okay. I'm fighting here. I'm going back to Ellen Page on this. I agree with both of your points, but I disagree when you say that Ellen Page playing Robin is beneath her. It's not beneath her because someone has to stand up to Ben Affleck as Batman. Ellen Page could really do that. Also, like I said, Ellen Page is an Oscar nominee. And if you branch out Robin to standalone films, someone has to carry those movies. Ellen Page has incredible background with two different superhero movies. She can hold her own in movies. She was in Inception, holding her own with Leonardo DiCaprio.
Right.
And I feel like that she does have the chops as an Oscar nominee to hold her own in a standalone Batman series. And it's important.
I think either of these guys could hold their own.
Right, the chops are not the question. She's already done it
right
with so many times. So she, as a woman, should be leading these things. She shouldn't be. And she shouldn't have to wait three films to lead a film.
But you're not
saying, hey, 10 years later, you can be Nightwing.
No one's saying,
oh, no, but if it results in her death, do we really want her ending that way?
Then you kill her off. As a female Robin, you kill her off?
You kill her off eventually. But you have to build up to that so that when she does get killed off,
Taron Egerton, she's Han fucking Solo.
I mean, seriously.
But when you build it up, when you have her play Robin a couple times, especially in a standalone film, when Robin does get killed off, it'll have much more of an emotional impact. And again, you know, this is a character that does deserve a standalone film. And a standalone film with Robin, a woman playing Robin is forward thinking, bouncing out, giving diversity.
No one's arguing that, but like the idea is that the death of Robin, she will eventually die. Taron Egerton is young enough to play that part, to build it up, to grow. He's done dramatic. He can go dark. He can go light. He played both of those in Kingsman, and that's why I think he should be Robin, because he's still young enough to play it. And if you go to her standalones, he will be at the perfect age to carry these things forward.
Yeah, but then he's going to die. So what if Ellen Page dies or Edgerton dies?
If Edgerton dies,
Nicholas Hoult dies, they're all going to die.
Remember when Nuts died and it was awesome? Yeah.
Yeah, it's okay. But I mean, but again, Ellen Page, you know, she's been at it for almost 10 years.
Yeah, but she's done it
already. She was great. Now, going back to Hard Candy in 2005,
Hard Candy, yes,
Juno in 2007,
right.
Inception in
with
2010,
Patrick Wilson.
She is an outstanding actress, fully worthy of playing Robin. It would really get a lot of ink and a lot of attention.
All right, I'm hearing a lot about the why. I need to hear about why not. But before you do that, I'd love to get you guys in. Tell me more about your people. Kim, Nicholas Hoult, why is he better than the other two?
I think he is a really good actor. He's not nominated for an Oscar yet, but I think he's on his way. I think it will happen one day. He's shown so many different sides of him.
None of these. Ellen has neither, right?
Yeah, she was nominated for Juno.
Yeah.
Oh,
she
Juno.
Was.
Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah.
So where she was the lead, by the way.
Yes, exactly.
So she's already a lead.
She's not a second banana.
Yeah, Colin Firth.
No, he's the lead.
You think he's the lead? I thought Colin Firth is like guiding him into being the lead.
He's the mentor.
So he's already doing the Batman Robin kind of thing.
He's probably in more screen time than Colin Firth is.
He's the Obi-Wan character.
But yeah, sorry, Nicholas Holt.
Not the lead. Sorry, I was thinking about Obi-Wan. So Nicholas Holt, we've seen him in a lot of different roles, taking him in different directions. I do think he has, you know, the balance of muscle, but also fragility and humor, and I think he has just the perfect balance to make this role work.
I don't think he's got the chops to take Robin into the darkness, and I think that's what we. That's
Does
what
Robin
we,
go into the darkness he, though? Which if, Robin? If you're gonna, which
if,
Robin?
Well, that's the thing. If what he Robin? Was pitching, well, I'll answer if you stop for a second. What Andy was pitching there is the death of Robin. That goes darker. He's gonna face the Joker. He will be killed. All those things you can go. If you go Death in the Family,
you want him to be Jason.
You can play all, but he can go whichever Robin you choose. Robin eventually goes dark, so because he either gets killed or he becomes Nightwing. They always go dark, Robin eventually, because it's Batman. No one goes light after spending time with Bruce Wayne and Batman for like 30 years.
Sure, Burt
nobody
Ward,
goes.
Right?
Nobody goes. Hey, I'm gonna go be happy.
Robin with Adam West. It was Burt Ward.
That was Burt Ward.
Yeah, that's
1966.
Let's not start there.
Kim, do you want to respond to any of that?
Yeah, I would argue that the character that I want, Dick Grayson, he has a special lightness to him. He is like the shining light of the DC universe, where he hasn't been corrupted, and he doesn't have... He's had horrible things happen to him, but he's still very positive and funny, and he brings so much needed light to that world.
So do you keep the light through the death? Are you implying that?
He's gonna, well...
If we're going with this route of the death...
where they just change...
If we're gonna do Death of Robin's storyline, do you think he can still remain light through that story?
Yeah. It'll hurt more, even with that'll
Beast,
be good.
Even with Beast, he can't bring the darkness. And Beast has a lot of internal struggles. I mean, even at the end of Days of Future Past, when Mystique is walking away from him, there's nothing going on in Nicholas's face that he's going to lose his wife his love for like forever.
All right, I need one last. You're going to go ahead, but this will be your closings for everybody. Give me your final closing statement, but not only why yours is right, but just give me the closing two and why the other two.
Close it to say that Ellen Page doesn't deserve to be Robin because it's a supporting role is BS. I just watched a bunch of movies with Sigourney Weaver, different actress, great actress, but she does a lot of supporting roles that are good and strong. So why can't Ellen Page do the same? So what if it's a supporting role? It has the potential to be a lead, and again to give it to the right person. She's got a lot of depth. She could be dark, she could be funny, she could be tough. That is what Robin needs, and that is why Ellen Page is the best Robin.
Everything he just said about Robin about Ellen Page, Taron Egerton is already done. Kingsman was basically a dry run to play Robin, and Ellen Page, I never said she doesn't deserve. I said that she is above it because she's already transcended it. She's already a fantastic established actress.
That's why she
could do more things. Okay, but Taron Egerton is the one who deserves it at this point in his career to establish himself, to blow himself up as an actor, and he has the ability to go dark and light, and we will go with him. We will go with him on the journey. With Ellen Page, she's nice. Nicholas Holt, they're nice. I like her too. I got nothing to go. But I think Taron, we have more possibilities, more probabilities with Taron Egerton as he progresses as an actor, as he grows as a man, as he goes into his things, and we will follow him as an audience. And I think he'll be really a good foil for Ben Affleck.
I see some serious passion here. You guys are going to get pissed no matter who I pick. Kim, let's get your closing in here.
Okay, here's the deal. Edgerton's not ready. She's too far. Mama Bear, Papa Bear.
Wow. Way. Ellen is
baby
not
Did you see
bar.
Kingsman? Did you
just
see Kingsman?
Just right. I think Nicholas Holt is just right in the sweet spot where he has enough under his belt that we can see he can do good, but he can do so much more. We have that potential there. We have that room to grow, but we also have that assurance.
But he doesn't even stand out from an ensemble.
But he actually would be a great Batman in Year One. If they ever did a Batman Year One, Nicholas Holt would be perfect.
No, he's too small.
As
for who?
Bruce Wayne.
As Nicholas Holt is Bruce Wayne.
Yes, I can see that. Batman Year One, no going back to basics.
No way. Woo!
All right.
Wow.
I'm processing this because this is actually a really tough one. Dan, anything to clean up while I take a moment to ponder these notes?
Well, just as an FYI, Ellen Page, 28. Taron Egerton and Nicholas Holt, both 25. And Ellen Page has a little experience doing this. She played Bolte, the sidekick role, and Super.
Yeah,
from James Gunn.
A little bit different tone.
James Gunn, that's right. Yeah. That's a crazy movie.
With a wrench.
Super.
That is a crazy movie.
I think you guys really went at it. I mean, you guys clear. I can tell. So there was some getting some anger.
We did it.
I loved it.
Oh yeah.
But then something happened. I think Kim swooped in at the very end with some really good points. And I think slow and steady won the race. Kim, I'm giving it to you. I liked your mama.
Good job.
I'm gonna give
it to Kim.
That's my strategy. Let them kill each other, and I'll
take it. Got a little aggressive and distracted, and I think you cleaned up the best out of your closing. So Kim gets the first point. Good
Way
job.
To go, Kim. Good job.
On the board. Kim. Round two. M. Night Shyamalan's The Visit opened number two at the box office, and critics actually like an M. Night Shyamalan movie again. Good for him. I'm happy for
him.
What
a twist.
Wow, that is a legitimate
twist.
Long
overdue.
It's currently 60% on time of taping and at Rotten Tomatoes, and I've heard people like it. I've heard people didn't like it, but I've heard more people that liked it than didn't like it. So Kevin Molus, I'm sorry, I'm butchering your name, Molusinian on Twitter asked us, pitch M. Night Shyamalan's next movie. Now, we're looking for a title, a co-star, and of course, we need a twist ending. But now he's back on track. Let's give him something fun. I'd love to hear pitches. John, you're starting first. What's your M. Night Shyamalan dream movie pitch?
Mine is called The Woman I Adore with Michael Fassbender, Charlize Theron, and Meryl Streep. The tagline is, some memories of high school are better left in the past. A man runs into an old high school flame and begins a torrid love affair with her after her husband has been mysteriously killed. As their obsession for each other grows, the woman moves her mother in to help her deal with her emotions over the death of her husband. Aren't we? Isn't that what we're doing?
Oh, they're so bummed they didn't do this. Keep going.
Okay.
I didn't do that.
As I was saying, as their obsession for each other grows, the woman moves her mother in to help her deal with her emotions over the death of her husband. The two eventually get married, and the man starts to experience random physical ailments that lead him to being driven mad with visions of murder. Eventually, we discover that this has all been in his head and that he is in an asylum for having killed the woman's husband, Ooh. Who was his nurse during a psychotic break he had after a high school reunion. The mother is actually his new nurse at the asylum.
Ooh. So just give me the summary again. So he's
a twist. It's a guy who falls in love with a woman who from high school.
We think we're watching that.
Right. But it ends up being that he has had a psychotic break after seeing her, kills her husband to have her, and it is all in his mind.
That's pretty fun. Good one. You just wrote a movie. Guys, I hope you prepared to write a movie like that because
nope.
You just did a good job. And you had Charlize Theron and Fassbender. All right.
Fassbender and Meryl Streep.
Wow, big cast. I mean, he did that movie for what, like a $10,000? I wonder if he'll get all these people right away after following up the visit. But hey, I loved it. All right, Kim, let's see your take.
I did not write something out. and this is going from the top of my head. So
love,
I hope I remember.
Sometimes the best way.
I call it The Apology, starring Adam Sandler. So, guess where I'm going
with
this?
It's a comedy, isn't it?
It is a comedy starring Adam Sandler, in which he does not play a racially offensive character or have racially offensive characters. He has no stupid voices. He does not have any blatant product placement. M. Night Shyamalan does have a cameo as a writer, a la Lady in the Water, except this time he's not the hero who saves the world with his supreme writing ability. And he actually verbally apologizes for Avatar The Last Airbender. And the critic character is not evil. The twist is there is no twist. It's straightforward and heartwarming. And we get a real apology, which is what we deserve.
There from is. Both Shyamalan and Adam Sandler.
Yes.
Wow, a double whammy apology. All right.
You could do it.
No.
All right, Scott, let's hear your pitch.
Okay, my pitch is Dorothy. The name of the movie is Dorothy. There is no place like home at the movies. This is the field of dreams for the 21st century. In the not-too-distant future, overpopulation, movie theaters are a thing of the past. Everybody watches everything on their phones. Everything is owned and run by Dan Cobbs, played by Woody Harrelson. He owns all the media. He owns everything. He's like Steve Jobs times 1,000. Chloe Grace Moretz plays Dorothy, named after Dorothy from The Wizard of Oz. Her father, played by Harrison Ford, ran a movie theater. Movie theaters are not in existence anymore. They are obsolete. But she goes to the movie theater that her dad used to run. It's run down. And her father appears out of nowhere. He's magical. He's been dead for years. She never met him because he died soon after she was born. And he says, if you build this movie theater up, classic movie characters from the past will come back and bring life back to this theater, and everybody will write about it, and movie theaters will come back into the world. So she enlists her friends, long story short, because this is a pitch, she enlists her friends and all these classic movie characters from the past, like Vito Corleone, Luke Skywalker, and they all come, and it gets all this media attention, and the evil guy played by Woody Harrelson is overthrown, and then we find out the twist is that this is all part of a pitch to a studio executive played by Woody Harrelson, who turns it down. And as Chloe Grace Moretz, who plays the writer, is leaving, she sees something on the internet that says that theaters all around the country are being shut down.
Whoa.
That so wait, is a movie.
So hold on. I'm trying to make sure I followed it.
Mm-hmm.
Is this like Last Action Hero? Or are the actual characters showing up?
The actual characters are showing up. Like Luke Skywalker is showing up. And Vito Corleone is showing up. Not the actors who play them.
Right. The characters. Real movie characters. Like in Last Action Hero.
Sort of like Last Action Hero. But more like Field of Dreams.
Basically. Okay. But yes, baseball instead of baseball players, they're movie stars. All right, great. Guys, fight. Which ones do you want to see? Which ones don't you want to see?
I mean, come on.
Do we
have to fight?
This is a mine pretty love much letter.
I mean, mine pretty much killed it. Do we have to fight?
Mine is a love letter to the movie.
Yeah, but Andy said what he said. Last Action Hero combined with Field of Dreams. And everybody hated Last Action Hero. But and
to
Shyamalan
be fair,
does
your
not
movie
build
reminds
upon.
Me of other movies, too.
Which movie is that?
The Visit, that one with Leonardo DiCaprio.
Shutter Island?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm with He's you. Like, I thought of Shutter. I totally thought of Shutter. No,
it's a... Does he have a psychotic break at a high school reunion? Because it doesn't feel like he does. Well, Shakespeare said there's only...
Kids
I mean, they said there's only six plots that have ever
that
been
That's the most amazing reversal of argument I've ever seen.
But this is
I don't
like,
lose.
Like Hugo.
Look,
was
I like your idea, but the problem is that there's
no problem.
Could get licenses for all those characters. It would be impossible. Well, he doesn't have the clout or the money to create that kind of film because there's no way he could get those people. And who are you going to get to play those characters?
If you change the character slightly and just make them characters like classic characters
from B movies that you can afford.
No. Like classic characters within that movie world.
Right.
You know, then you have some flexibility with that. But the point is that this is a love letter to the movies. This is also a cautionary tale because too many people are watching movies now on their phones. They're not going to movies enough to see movies in theaters.
That's not true. Have you seen the Jurassic World box
office?
Well,
yeah.
And in fact,
that
according
is the
to,
exception to
according
the rule.
According to Forbes,
too many people
are 15% ahead of 2014.
Too many people are watching their movies on these things instead
of
watching them
All right. I'm not calling it, but I'm calling order. Why not the other one?
Mine's better. Mine's better. Mine is a love letter to the movies. Like I can actually see this movie getting made. This is more than just a pitch. This is like something that,
But
Hollywood.
Why, John? Yeah. Why not the others?
His is a Spielberg movie. His is something that's not
and
something.
And Shyamalan
right,
was the next
me,
Spielberg.
He asked me. That's a Spielberg movie. Shyamalan would not thrive in a Spielberg movie, nor would he do this. He should is not the argument, is it? He would not. He would come nowhere near that film, and he would never apologize. Because one thing you know about Shyamalan is he is cocky and arrogant about what he does, which is why he keeps going.
It's worked so
well for him too. None of us have
it. Sounds like someone during this fight, but sadly, he's the only one that gave me the right argument. You. Copped out at the end, and this pitch is ridiculous as funny as it is.
I don't need a movie.
Based on the arguments...
I need an apology.
Don't worry.
Based on the arguments, I'm going with John on the board.
Who else?
John's on the board. Kim's on the board.
You were close, but you gave up at the end.
Man's
Mine's
off
better.
The board.
We'll never win a movie fight. Round three. And sorry, Kim. It was funny, but that was impossible.
It's fine. All I really, truly want is an apology.
I'm with you.
Very quickly, Andy.
Yeah, sorry, Dan. I just had to steamroll that one on.
Poor M. Night Shyamalan can't catch a break.
Is he down now?
He was at 60%. A bad review must have come
since
in,
those 5
which
minutes?
Ticked him down to 59%, which, as you know, on Rotten Tomato means that it goes from fresh to rotten.
Oh, wait, can I just say,
back in
2000, when Unbreakable came out, Shyamalan was on the cover of Time Magazine, and it said the next Spielberg.
Oof. It's
so,
true.
There you go.
But you need to knock his pitch at why that didn't work, and you didn't. So we're on round three. Round three. There it is.
There it is.
Johnny Depp Black Mass is opening this weekend, and some are calling it a return to form for Depp, which is great to see him not being a pirate or Willy Wonka or some other weird stuff.
Right.
It's nice to have him go back to his roots and do something different.
Good.
Would you disagree?
You know what I picked for what his best character is.
I didn't actually.
And you said pirate.
Uh-oh.
Uh-oh.
Well, I didn't know. So, well, there you go.
I claim bias to start.
Uh-oh. We'll see. So that was Sway Me.
It's about arguments.
I mean, he's not playing Jack Sparrow again, right? You're picking something new, I hope. We'll see in a minute. Fight three. Oh, wait. Oh, crap. I'm sorry. It is... it is that. No, and then you're right. I meant next. Playing it next. Best Johnny Depp performance is the question from Daniel Lewis. I just don't want to see him do it a fifth time. I'm glad he's doing
Black Mask. I want a new judge.
I'm glad he's doing Black Mask. But Johnny Depp, Jack Sparrow, which I'm assuming you're picking, is an amazing performance.
That open bar.
First one. You can't go the other way.
Is that what you're picking, Kim?
You have the paper. You know what I picked.
I don't have the paper.
Why don't you have a paper?
I should have the paper.
That open bar at the Streamies was great.
For the record,
this is awesome.
Johnny Depp as Captain Sparrow is one of his best performances. Wait, Johnny Depp in Part 5, it's like, come on already. Let's see Black Mass. I like that he's mixing up his filmography.
He was nominated for that.
Yeah, Jack Sparrow's a fantastic performance. So, Kim, I assume you're picking Jack Sparrow, and then there's no
bias.
Yes,
I'm picking
bias.
Jack Sparrow.
Jack Sparrow's amazing. Tell us why.
Okay, that is the only role in this group of three he's actually been nominated for an Academy Award for. And in a comedic role, which is so rare. I mean, you can argue that, yes, those movies did get tiresome, but we're talking about which is his best character, not which are his best movies. And is it really Johnny's fault that the character was so memorable and lovable that Disney decided to milk it dry until we were all sick of the franchise? No, that's not his fault. He created an amazing fucking character, and he deserves recognition for it.
True. Facts. Scott.
Edward Scissorhands. This is the first role where Johnny Depp did not play into his good looks. It's as a modern day Frankenstein. Mm-hmm. This was, but I mean, with the cover with all the makeup, I mean, this was a modern day Frankenstein. It was the quintessential collaboration between Johnny Depp and his longtime collaborator, Tim Burton. This was a fairy tale. It was beautiful. It had so much heart. It was funny. He was stylish. And it was just a beautiful, beautiful character. And it was just a modern day fairy tale. It's the character that I remember the most, more than any other Depp performance, because it hit me with so much heart. So much heart in that movie. It's a
John,
perfect film.
What's your pick?
I think both of you have chosen some really great performances.
But
for me, my number one favorite Johnny Depp performance, not film performance, what we're talking about, is Donnie Brasco. He's never better in anything that he is in Donnie Brasco. Yes, exactly. I mean, he's best known for these quirky, vulnerable man-child roles, but this was just the part he was born to. Like, he's a man in this movie. He comes into his own and his powers as an actor. Yes, he's fine in Edward Scissorhands, where he speaks five words maybe, and then he's great in Jack Sparrow, but eventually he became a caricature of his own character that he created. But in Donnie Brasco, there's really some depth going on, some vulnerability, some strength, and he walks that tightrope. And it is a tightrope between being this father with his child, with his children and his wife, and then getting lost and being engrossed by becoming part of the mafia world. The vulnerability he shows. Plus, he's holding his own at times and even beating Al Pacino. And this is one of Al Pacino's last best performances as an actor, and Johnny Depp is holding his own and at times even beating him during certain scenes. Even Janet Maslin of the New York Times said, with this film, his career reaches critical mass, turning the assortment of varied offbeat roles into the trajectory of a major star. He has a hard-boiled grace in this film, and I think what he's doing in Edward Scissorhands, what he does in Jack Sparrow, those are nice performances, they're good performances, but I think you see the power, true power he has as an actor in Donnie Brasco.
That shoe scene, right?
Yeah.
These are all good. And to clarify, because I know you think I'm being biased, the other Pirates movies don't count. We're talking about right. Pirates 1, correct? Which is a great performance. So let's go back. Fight Jack Sparrow versus Donnie Brasco versus Edward Scissorhands. This is tough.
Yep. Well, if no one's going to start, Edward Scissorhands is great, but like I said, he doesn't talk much. He does great with visual. He does great with just basically mask work.
That's
what
makes
doing.
It a great performance.
And it's vulnerable and it's tender. I get
first
all
of all,
that.
First of
however,
all,
you get all of that in Donnie Brasco, and you
Donnie
get this
Brasco is a solid character. It is not Donnie Brasco is a solid character. It's not an unforgettable character.
That's fair.
It is not an unforgettable character. I mean, I was entertained while I was watching. Forgot about it. And by the way, Al Pacino, his best role, I mean, his last great role, I mean, Insomnia. Okay.
No.
But Insomnia was 2002. Insomnia was 2000. Okay, but I'm digressing. It's not about Pacino.
Remake.
It's about. But
yeah.
No.
Keep it on Depp.
Yes.
But,
okay, Insomnia was 2002.
Staying on Depp here, that the fact
and
that
I said one of his
the fact
last
that
great
Edward Scissorhands, he did not have a lot of dialogue, but he wound up being such an unforgettable character is a testament to his performance. He didn't need words.
Versus Sparrow. Also, I'd love to hear your thoughts.
Okay, Sparrow is also solid. It's fun. It's comedic. It's a definite landmark for him, but he took a bigger chance before that when he did Edward Scissorhands, and it still holds up. It is a timeless classic character in a timeless classic film.
I'm going to agree that he gave a great performance in Edward Scissorhands. However, he started to create a kind of an archetype of a character with that role, which is the messy, black-haired, pale-faced weirdo.
Yeah, the man-child.
And he's done it many, many times.
We're talking just about this movie.
Does it stand heads and shoulder above the other characters that are like that, that he's done? I don't know if that's true. And on that same note, I don't know if Donnie Brasco isn't a memorable enough character.
I'm with you on Donnie Brasco.
You're both crazy.
No.
You're a film
right.
critic saying that Donnie Brasco is not memorable to you.
No, I said it was solid. I didn't say it was bad.
It's good.
I didn't say it was bad.
I didn't say it wasn't unforgettable.
Well, they're going the memorable. They're going the memorable route, which it's a fair thing to do. So chime in. Go ahead.
I think it's absolutely memorable because you got a glut of mafia films, and Donnie Brasco still stands out. Why? Because Depp carries that film as much as Pacino carries that film. You have the good back and forth between the two. This is a Tim Burton film, Scissorhands.
Yes, it is.
Depp does a great performance,
but so does
Winona Ryder. So does everybody else in that film.
They elevated each other.
But I think
Tim Burton and Johnny Depp elevated each other. Even people who never saw Edward Scissorhands love Edward Scissorhands because the character is so great.
I can yell louder, too. I mean, I'm not...
You're already yelling.
Order. Chris, this is pretty fun, right?
This is great.
All right, just to order. Yeah. Got it. Why not Jack Sparrow, John?
I think he based it on Keith Richards, so already wasn't an original creation. And he does...
Every character is based.
That's not true. You're an actress? You know that every character is based.
Are you an actor?
Yes, I am.
Really?
And a good one.
I didn't.
Actor who can't remember his lines.
Well, this is different.
You're just mad you didn't come as prepared.
Right. It's all in here, my friend. I don't need to write it down.
No. But you're knocking it down because it's a Keith Richards.
But I'm not knocking it. Like, it's a great character. It's a great performance. It's fantastic. I just think it becomes a bit of a caricature throughout the film, and the whole, like, hey, I'm playing drunk and I'm doing, like, all of that is just, it's fantastical. And I think with Donnie Brasco, there's a real truth and power in his performance that I think elevates. And he's doing the stuff he did in Edward Scissorhands, the man-child stuff.
Which one of these roles was he nominated for an Academy Award for?
Well,
which one was a, how many,
I mean,
how many best actors
Academy
are
Awards,
in comedy? This was an incredible landmark
Citizen
piece.
Kane
I mean, by
lost
now,
best picture, so.
It's probably old hat because we've seen it again and again and again, but we're going to focus on who the character is, where he started. I think it's an incredible character. Yeah, he's somewhat based on Keith Richards, but it's also...
Somewhat.
Listen, you.
You chimed in.
The thing is, a lot of characters are based on something else. Inspiration is okay, and to knock that down is a true disservice.
Cool.
Edward Scissorhands.
Final thought.
Johnny
Scott.
Depp did more with less. He did so much more by saying so little. That is a performance. That is true acting. That is why it is a classic, timeless, unforgettable character with heart and humor, and is just a masterpiece.
And why not? I know why you said not Brasco, but why not Sparrow?
Listen, Sparrow's great. But I do think that he became a caricature as the movie progressed. I think it's a very, very good performance. And honestly, after Edward Scissorhands, that's who I picked. So it was my second favorite out of these three.
I swapped mine the other way.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Aw, Kim.
All right.
I hate to be in the middle of
these. Dan, any thoughts there?
A few things. Edward Scissorhands says 169 words in the movie, not
I apologize.
Five. Johnny Depp was nominated for a Golden Globe for Edward Scissorhands and Pirates, but Pirates was the only one he was nominated of those three for an Oscar for. I believe when you're discounting Al Pacino's role in Night Falls when you say...
sounds like a cool movie.
And Pepe Le Pew, also an inspiration for Jack Sparrow.
Oh,
and Donnie Brasco was a real person, so you could say he based his performance on the real person.
Yeah, but he never interviewed him.
Well,
he never interviewed him.
All right. This is legitimately tough. All three performances, and I do remember that performance. That shoe scene, it was a crazy, great scene. It's a great movie if you haven't seen Donnie Brasco. They're all great movies, but it came down to these two. I got to be honest, based on the arguments, and Scott crushed it for me at the end. So Scott gets the point. Edward Scissorhands, best performance by Scott. Very close.
You and I are the same page.
I mean, it was a really good role.
By the way,
those are really good roles, and that's a good role. But these, the memorableness. Really helps. He came prepared, Scott.
But
it's not my fault.
Andy, it's right here. It's right here.
Well, then quit complaining. You don't need paper. Oh, you're judging that we don't have a memory like you?
No,
come
I'm
on.
Just jealous because I didn't think to bring my notes.
John. Round four.
I was taking on Scott Mance. How do you not come prepared?
You got me. You got
like
him.
It's Scott Mance.
All right. It was announced this week that Elizabeth Banks is in talk to direct a new Charlie's Angels movie. So Jarrett Johnson at Kali 1991 on Twitter asked us, pitch us your dream cast for a Charlie's Angels reboot. And now we're back to you, Scott, to start us.
Okay.
What would your dream cast be for a Charlie's Angels reboot?
I put a lot of thought into this.
I know you
a lot of thought into this. Boy, did I love Charlie's Angels back in the 70s. Yes, I'm that old. I have gray hair. I am the older version of Max Landis.
There it is.
Yay.
But yes, it's on camera. I admit it. But and I got to say, the two that Drew Barrymore and you know did back in 2000 and 2003, the second movie, Full Throttle, was actually pretty good.
No.
But now let's reboot it and let's go back and let's really make it a kick-ass Charlie's Angels movie. Only one
Who's
way to do
cast?
That. I'm doing Jennifer Lawrence. She's the leader. She's the blonde, feisty leader. She's smart. She's got the bronze. She's sexy. She's proven she can carry a franchise with Hunger Games, and she's also kick-ass as Mystique in X-Men. Then you've got Zoe Saldana. She is a good luck charm for film franchises. Star Trek, Avatar, Guardians of the Galaxy, and also diversity. You need to have a diverse Charlie's Angels cast. Finally, Emily Blunt, the brainy brunette. She kicked butt in Edge of Tomorrow, saw that movie right out from under Tom Cruise, mm-hmm. and also she was terrific in Sicario, which is in theaters right now. The three of them together, that is a kick-ass team of Charlie's Angels, folks.
That's a good choice. Yeah. John, what are you picking for your Charlie's Angels?
Well, it's hard to say, to scream about diversity and then say two white women in one. I would say my choices are Hayley Atwell, Jennifer Lawrence, and Zoe Saldana.
Very diverse as well.
Yeah, I know as well. But I didn't claim diversity. I didn't claim that. For me, actually, in this set...
Wow, two out of three.
Yeah, yeah, I was going to say. I was just going to say. I agree with two out of three with Mance, and I don't want to get into the pitch-perfect Charlie's Angels that's coming. But for me... To me, these two, Jennifer Lawrence actually could play against type and be.
Well, you're on the same. So just tell me why Hayley Atwell's better.
Well,
than
Hayley Atwell would be the leader, not Jennifer Lawrence. That's
my
approach.
Your difference.
That's what
and
I would
then
say.
Why Hayley over Emily Blunt?
Well, I think because Hayley's already proven that she can kick ass and carry a team like she did in Agent Carter, and she was great in the small parts she had in Ant-Man. She's a fantastic actress. Plus, she's not your typical waifish actress. And I think with this new advent that's going on in with women now, we want to see real women, real courage. Real looks, and I think Hayley Atwell has that, and I love that about her. Zoe Saldana also, obviously, same agreement, brings international flavor. She's Latina, and I'm Latino, and I would love to see that. And I think the three of them would work better together. I don't think Emily Blunt is playing second banana anymore. I think this woman is a lead, and not Jennifer Lawrence. I think
so
those two
like
would
Ellen
battle.
Page.
Whereas Cameron Diaz is easier playing the second fiddle to Drew Barrymore. I think Jennifer Lawrence could play against type and play second fiddle to Hayley Atwell because I think Hayley is the leader of the team and also kicks ass and is sexy.
Kim, let's hear your cast.
I want to start by saying that all women are real women.
there you go.
Anyway, I didn't pick the same two actresses for both my roles.
You did it. You have three new actresses?
I did pick the cast of Pitch Perfect,
yes.
though. So I chose Anna Kendrick, Rebel Wilson, and Brittany Snow. Now, hear me out. These women do not have, you know...
Color.
Predictability.
Sure.
As action stars, whatever. But this is an Elizabeth Banks movie. And you saw Pitch Perfect 2. Would you agree that she's a strong director
no.
and can direct your women?
At all. Not at all.
No.
John Rogan's really going for the heel into this episode.
No, I'm sorry.
I don't agree with that. I think she could direct my women.
I don't think she's a strong enough director.
I think she could direct
I think
my
oh,
that
I see what you're saying.
The strength
oh.
of these three women and their chemistry okay. together and their history with Banks would lead to a
Got
comedic,
it.
Fun romp of a movie, which is really what Charlie's Angels is. It's not not a serious drama action movie. It's silly. It's campy, and it's supposed to be.
But, oh, can I jump in there?
Yeah, we jump in.
Now it's time for fighting.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm writing stuff down.
I didn't have it pre-written, mister, because it's all here.
Silly campy. Is yours silly and campy?
Mine is not silly and campy. Mine is fun. Mine takes it a little more seriously and takes it to a respectable level above what the other two Charlie's Angels movies were. The other two movies were, again, I liked them. They were fun. They were campy. They were like the Powerpuff Girls, live action versions of the Powerpuff Girls. Yeah. Let's take Charlie's Angels to another level. Let's really give it A-list credibility. Again, Jennifer Lawrence, she's a natural born leader. Zoe, I'm with you on Zoe.
Yeah.
The reason I take Emily Blunt over Haley, first of all, Haley is fine, but she's not there yet. She's not there yet. Agent Carter, she's good. It's TV. Emily Blunt is a movie star. She is a great actress.
Yes.
She's a great action hero. She's a great action hero. Sicario,
she's the lead.
Hang on.
Yeah.
She is so good.
I can hang on. Okay.
She is so good in Sicario. She is like what Jodie Foster was in Silence of the Lambs.
Right.
That's what that character reminded me of in Sicario.
Right.
And then in Edge of Tomorrow, she was such a great character that it didn't matter that she was a woman. She was just a great character.
So how does this play into your movie?
How's this playing in my movie? Well, first of all, I think that Elizabeth Banks could direct these ladies, especially if Elizabeth Banks plays the villain against these three ladies. These ladies could kick ass, and I just don't think that the cast of Pitch Perfect, what are they going to break out of the song? I just think it's a little too lightweight.
You don't know? Song battles are awesome.
I agree. I think that'll be fun, but I think, you know, after all these years, it's been 12 years since the last Charlie's Angels movie, the last one was 2003, that McGee directed. Let's really give Charlie's Angels the love and affection and the respectability, especially in this day and age where you need strong female characters, not cheesy, campy female characters, in a kick-ass movie that men and women and adults and kids will all love.
Yeah, but I think with my cast...
Final thoughts,
you know. Yeah, I think with my cast, you get all of that, plus you get their ability to play lighter, to play funnier, to do them. They've all done funnier part. Haley has great funny moments in Agent Carter, which you obviously don't appreciate, and I think Emily Blunt, it's more difficult for her to play comedy. Like, she struggles through. I didn't talk to you. She struggled through Devil Wears Prada at times to have the comedic moments. Her more dramatic moments were better realized in those films. And yes, she is a star. Absolutely. That's why she can't play second lead to, or second dog, or to Jennifer Lawrence. Where I think Haley is still building her credibility, it makes more sense for her to play second behind Jennifer Lawrence, and you have Zoe Saldana. So those three have all proven they can play drama, they can play comedy, they can play light, and they can do it effectively. And I think this is what you want. You want a franchise. Plus, it works for your, as a studio, you don't have to pay them high-end salaries. You can go a little bit lower with Hayley Atwell, and then you have to pay Jennifer Lawrence and a little bit in between Zoe Saldana. So it just makes all sense perfectly. And I think they work together as a team. I wouldn't want Elizabeth Banks as the villain at all.
I would. I think that'd be awesome.
Unless it's a funny movie, because
right.
I feel like else she could. But this would be a
Kim,
good Jonas.
Kim, heard all their takes. What response to that?
I'm a little insulted that Anna Kendrick and Rebel Wilson are not seen as like girl power roles. They really brought it, especially Anna Kendrick in the
Who's
second.
Who's saying that though? No one's saying
I
that.
I think I heard that as an argument. Furthermore, I'm gonna say that Jennifer Lawrence is too good for Charlie's Angels movie. She's an Oscar-winning actress. She is beyond this.
Okay.
And Zoe Saldana, I mean, I love her, but she needs to do a different kind of role. And she's been doing this and doing this and doing this, this like kind of like cool girl action, whatever. I want to see her do something else.
Okay.
I'm calling it.
Ooh. Oh.
Those are all your thoughts.
Harry.
As they knock over Harry.
No, not this palace.
Dan, anything you'd like to add here?
Let's see. Elizabeth Banks co-star with Jennifer Lawrence in the Hunger Games films, and I keep thinking John's gonna shove Scott in a locker and like ask him for his lunch money or something.
Beat him up.
It's an unexpected heel turn.
I'm scared for
Broca. What love, man? It's all good. Yeah. We're bonding here.
This
we are bonding.
Friends do this. People love movies.
Chris, I want to have you help me here, activating you. Thoughts on this round?
I would go with Mance because of Emily Blunt.
I love you, man.
Because of his argument for Emily Blunt.
With Emily Blunt in there, she showed what she could do with Tom Cruise, and she held her own against Tom Cruise in Edge of Tomorrow.
Got it. Okay, fair note. Doesn't mean that's the winner, but I want to hear you out. I actually wrote down my winner already to prove that that wouldn't sway my opinions. To me, based on the arguments, I kind of think you two ate each other a little bit. And it just became too same-same. And I think Kim, at the very end, came through and really proved that they're kind of too good for this movie. And
we just got bitch slapped.
But we went the camp. And I think she's right. We shouldn't just assume the same two action hero ladies have to do the action hero movie. Let's let the fun ones have a shot and be the action heroes, like she's saying. So I think, and I also liked, you're right. If she's directing, this is a way better cast for her to direct than Jennifer Lawrence and all of these amazingly, I think, just highly dramatic actors that she should deal with right out the gate. So Kim gets another point.
Kim's taking the lead.
I hope you're not offended. Thank you for
Baca,
the thoughts. I went against you. Baca, what? Round five. The second official trailer for the new movie Creed was released, and JT is losing his mind. JT literally, I think, is just like watching it every night before bed. He's shaking his head. I know you are, JT. And so much so that JT, our very own JTE, at Schmoes JTE on Twitter asks, and we're putting it up here because I know how much he loves this, what is the best Rocky fight? In honor of Creed, we got to do this, and there's so many battles that Rocky's had. John, yep. You're fighting first. What's the best Rocky fight?
All right, I'm going completely against type and what everyone else is going to choose, what you would think Rocky fight, and I go with the fight he had with Thunderlips in Rocky III with Hulk Hogan. I thought this was because all his fights are comical. No one fights defense. Apparently, these are people fighting for the heavyweight championship and can't figure out to put their hands in front of their faces. It's the most ridiculous. His fights are ridiculous. But this one against Hogan makes sense because of the way he fights, which is almost wrestling type fighting with the whole like no defense and giving into the bunches. And I thought, and Hulk Hogan overweighs, or Thunderlips outweighs him by 100 pounds, right? He was absolutely destroying him physically in the arena. Rocky never fought in professional wrestling, and he was actually getting his butt kicked by him. Parts of his body were being attacked that were never trained to defend with his boxing training. He got thrown into the crowd. And then he came back into the fight, cut off his gloves, readjusted his approach, and then he saved countless fans from being thrown all around the ring by Thunderlips, who was throwing people left and right in the stands. He used his boxing and strategy when he got back into the ring to break Thunderlips down with shots to the body, and then applied the sleeper hold. So he adjusted and went into wrestling mode and got him down to his knees, and then he picked up a man who is 100 pounds heavier than himself and threw him outside the ring into the crowd, showing his power and smarts, and he won the respect of the ultimate male versus the ultimate meatball. And that's why I think this is the best Rocky fight in all the movies.
Rocky versus Hulk Hogan. Got it.
Thunderlips, yeah.
Thunderlips. Kim, best Rocky fight?
It's Ivan Drago, obviously. I mean, this man, we've seen him be built up as kind of like a monster, machine even. And then we see him destroy Apollo Creed, and it's horrifying. It's heartbreaking what he does to him. He has that famous line, if he dies, he dies. He does not give a fuck about life. All he cares about is his own power and his own succeeding at all costs, at the cost of humanity even. And eventually Rocky, yeah, his own humanity. And then Rocky eventually does actually throw him, despite being larger, in his final fight. And
20 pounds.
It's a crazy fight. And then he comes out hammering him. There's no like jabbing and guarding. It's a brutal fight. But then Rocky gets the upper hand. He's the only person ever to defeat this man. It and he did it for his friend Apollo. And it's so touching.
Wow. All right. Movie man Scott, what are you picking?
I'm going with Rocky 1, 1976. Fights Apollo Creed, loses, but gets the girl.
Wait, we're talking about the fight, though, not the result of the fight.
No, we're talking about the fight, the impact the fight. Of that fight.
No, it's
he had.
Well, you could
lose.
Argue the fight got him the girl.
Right.
True.
Well, I mean, but the point is,
women
that movie
objects.
Came out in 1976.
Thank you.
That movie came out in 1976.
Oh, shut up. Don't watch it.
Erwin Winkler directed, right? 1976. Movie won Best Picture, Best Director because
John Avildsen
directed.
Erwin Winkler produced with Robert Chartles.
But that movie Okay, thank you. You corrected the man. That's a big deal. On camera. But okay, yeah, so you guys should have written it down. I should have brought my notes that you're reading from. But this was a drama. It would have been very easy for Rocky to win because he won basically every other fight at the end of every other movie. At the end of this movie, he lost. And you really didn't know what was going to happen. The intensity, the suspense, it was a real edge of your seat thing, and he really went the distance. But he lost the battle, but he won the war because he got the girl, and that is why the movie won Best Picture.
All right, guys, battle.
Okay, it establishes the foundation for the franchise. Absolutely. However, all the middle rounds are missing. So you don't have any sense of feeling the drama. You could argue the Rocky 2 fight is better than the Rocky 1 fight because you get the back and forth and the building of the drama.
You know
Rocky
1,
you don't get that. You don't know he was going to win or lose.
I knew he was going to win Rocky 2.
But I mean in the first one. You didn't know what was going to happen.
Exactly.
There's nothing in the middle rounds to build the drama. You just show up in the 13th round, or the 14th round rather. And then it's like, oh, okay, I guess he got beat up. And it's like it's a nice like dramatic, but it's not the best fight. Like
but it
you
is
see
the
him
best
at the beginning, and he does the shock.
You don't know
and
what's
going to
happen.
Keeps, but then you don't know. But
you're
you don't know the drama built in.
At the end of Rocky 3, at the end of Rocky 4, at the end of Rocky 5, I knew he was going to win.
Well, of course,
everybody
because
he was gonna
because
win.
No one's going to go see the movie. He's going to lose.
Your fight with Hulk Hogan.
Yeah.
What was at stake? What was at stake in that fight?
Charity.
Oh, please. Charity.
Money for kids.
Wait, yes, man,
some of us care about humanity.
But
I'm just saying.
Okay,
Rocky
listen,
did.
You want humanity? What about love? Love is the biggest part of
humanity.
You
had love. Love for those poor kids who needed the money.
Is equal to the love you make.
Oh, that's a Beatles reference.
That is definitely a Beatles reference. For everyone who knows
you're
me,
you're not
that's
the
a
only old one on this panel.
Yeah, as fun as this is to watch.
But I would say the
he had to lose.
But I would say the Rocky IV one is ridiculous. I mean,
it's cheesy.
It's cheesy.
I mean,
it's
fun.
They don't.
But it's
they
cheesy.
Don't. In no way they defend each
that's
other.
That's a guilty pleasure.
There's no way he would get knocked down 46 times and keep fighting.
Yes.
And they pick him up. He picks
he
him up
it.
Not
10 realistic.
Pounds.
Again,
it's realistic.
The man.
And,
it's not realistic.
And if we're talking results of the fight, we get the terrible Rocky V where he has brain damage as a result of Rocky IV.
Because
so that
he
should nullify
so
Rocky
hard.
IV. Completely. And that speech at the end. Beyond cheese.
Yeah, it's so
beyond
cheesy.
Cheese.
It's a guilty pleasure.
It's a guilty
and
pleasure.
Does that make
most.
It bad?
No,
because you love it.
It does.
And it's an amazing fight.
And no one does he have time to have like a fight with the Russian premier before he goes into the final round. If this is a really sanctioned fight, which it was, not for the title, but it was a sanctioned fight, there's no way they would allow all the stuff that happens in that fight. It's just a ridiculous
response
fight.
It's still, that's why it's amazing. It doesn't have to follow your rules of life. This is the movie. It's magic.
Oh, well, then in
anyway,
that case.
Drago is... He could kill a horse with a punch. It's
incredible.
It's
not realistic.
It's not
Mongo.
Realistic. It's not Blazing Saddles.
I mean,
hold on. Let's get it out.
Okay, go ahead.
I think one of the reasons that you were talking about you know the fight with Apollo, that's why the fight with Drago mattered so much. It was it was after the fact that he had killed him in the ring, and he has this guilt of not throwing in the towel. People screaming at him, throw in the towel, but he was trying to be true to his friend who said, you know, don't do it, no matter what, don't do it. He did this for him. It mattered that much more.
Yeah, but that's by rote at this point in the Rocky franchise, Rocky IV, because he did the same thing with Rocky III when Mickey died. When Mickey dies, he did the same thing in Rocky III. So he already established that, and Mickey told him not to go in the ring to fight Thunderlips. Mickey told him not to put himself
Creed
in danger.
Matters more
and
than Mickey.
You're out of your mind.
I am
you're
in
out
my
of your
mind.
Mind.
I am exactly
is
where
no
my
Rocky.
Mind needs to
there
be.
There is no Rocky without Mickey. If there's no Mickey and Adrian, there's no way. Is your I just my mind's about to blow up. No,
but
Mickey
end,
is the one.
All right, and, man. So go
at
ahead.
The end of the first movie, this is back in 1976, before anybody knew what a Rocky was, and that you're just he's so easy to root for, and that you're watching him get the crap kicked out of him. He is getting pulverized by Rocky by Apollo. Creed, but you are still on the edge of your seat because you really don't know. You think he's going to win. The movies are called Rocky. How could he lose? And then he loses, and then it hits you in the gut. It hits you in the heart more than any other fight in any other Rocky movie. I don't care if it's for charity. I don't care if it's
obviously
if it's for the
the
Cold
Barry
War.
Character you're arguing.
But it's he did it for love. He did it for love. It didn't matter. In the end, he got the girl.
No, no, no.
That means more.
What about
that? That was the prize. That was the prize.
Whoa!
There you go.
Women are
sexist.
Not prizes.
You're
no,
being
no, no,
sexist.
No. The prize was not the girl.
You
the prize
him,
was that he he won her love. Look what you're doing! Look what you're doing! Okay, come on. Just for that, Rambo is going to kick your ass.
No, but this is he didn't do it for love. He did it to prove to himself that he could survive.
He got
that
in
fight.
The ring and he
right,
survived.
Right, but the fight itself. What you're saying? We just get Rocky at the end.
You
were
on the edge of my seat.
Where is in the Hogan fight? There's no chance he could win this.
I was
there's
on the
no
edge of
chance
my seat
you don't think he can win
old.
This. And then he picks up
eight-year-old
a man who's 100 pounds heavier than him.
Watching that first Rocky.
Are you queuing to the camera? Are you doing the Rocky? Are you
I'm
really
just talking,
looking
I'm talking
at the
to the. I'm talking to my boy Dan. Talking to my boy Dan.
No, my boy
Dan. Dan can.
Oh, Dan.
I am saying.
But here's the deal.
No, the deal is.
Listen,
the
this
deal
is
this.
It establishes
that was a ballsy thing.
No one
that was
thought,
a ballsy move.
No one thought
to call
he was Hulk Hogan
Rocky
win.
He lost the freaking fight.
I'm not gonna. Hulk Hogan is 100 pounds heavier than him.
He
has to cut off his gloves.
Best picture
he has to
director.
Use his real.
Oh yeah! My God!
Woo! You
oh,
up,
wow.
Buddy.
Yes!
Aren't you glad you sat them together?
Yes.
This is a fight.
Can I nominate this for best Rocky?
By the way, I've never had a good movie fight as I have this time.
Everyone says it's Roger Barr versus Mundy, but I don't know. I think we have a new...
He uses his real fists in the Hogan fight.
He
that
uses
matters.
His heart in
JT,
Rocky.
Can I hear you? Do you have a mic? No, I can't
JT,
hear you.
JT, come on. JT,
This was your question. I'm just curious your thoughts. Who do you think? One, two, or three? Pull up based on the arguments.
I can't.
Oh, no. Here we go.
Yes! He picked one. JT in the booth. Sorry, I went on the camera there. He picked one. And I honestly, that's where I'm leaning to. I was with you, actually, because I like it. But I think they point out the silliness and that because of the argument. And I think you pull up the stakes, even though it's not about for the girl. But thematically, she has
sexism
a choice.
Sexism wins again.
She has a choice. Ugh. But, you know, based on the story, it helps. So Movie Mance gets it for Rocky 1.
Rocky nice. 1.
Adrian!
If I
wow.
May.
Dan, sorry.
Oh, Dan, here we go. If I
man, I you came for a good one, Chris, huh?
Americans around the world, I think, are angry at John for his crap talking about one of the greatest moments of American history, which is, if you could change, and I could change, everybody could change. That's one of the greatest moments in American history.
Oh, God.
And none of you picked the best one, which is Rocky II.
Rocky II.
So.
Yeah. Rocky II.
That's objectively the best fight.
Yeah. That was 1979, right?
Rocky I don't II. Care. It's a great fight.
Directed by who, Mance?
Doesn't matter what year. Okay, round six.
I'm out of this. I feel like I'm out of this.
No.
You got to get one more, and it's a tie.
Okay. Right.
And then the first trailer for Jon Favreau's live-action Jungle Book was released. We have a Disney movie coming next week, right? On his trailer?
We do have a Disney movie.
So this is a nice, convenient tease.
Nice plug.
Nice, convenient tease. We sometimes do it. We stop doing it all the time, but... Tease for Honest Trailers. We will have a movie that's a Disney movie.
Not the Jungle Book.
Not the Jungle Book, but that sort of era. Mm-hmm. There's another Disney adaptation coming soon, so that's your tease. All right, but now, before that, Jungle Book is what we're talking about. And so the question I wanted to bring up was, which is based off a question from Gazabelle, but let's say the Disney, like Iron Man started the MCU, what other Disney movie could be created in a live-action Disney universe using the Jungle Book as its... sort of starter, is there another animated classic that could almost join the Disney live action universe? Which one would we want to see next and how can we connect it? That's the question, and we're going to start with Kim.
Yay, I choose Aladdin. This is an obvious choice. This is an adventure. It has a great message, which is be yourself, and we have so many beautiful scenes in this. We have the Cave of Wonders. We have Agrabah. We have them going to a whole new world on a magic carpet. And they see so many different things. It would be visually stunning. There's a great action sequence of when they're trying to get out of the collapsing Cave of Wonders. We have also this is in the wake of the death of Robin Williams. This could be a touching tribute. This is a good time for this. I mean, if you've ever seen the Aladdin musical, Disney's California Adventure, there are some added songs, and it does lead to a great show.
Or the Broadway show.
Or the Broadway right, yeah. show. I meant something that I've seen close to here and was easy and free.
Cheaper, yes.
And cheaper.
Much cheaper.
Much cheaper.
But I hear the Broadway show is great, too. Yeah. All right. Great. Good start. Scott, what's your pick?
Okay, my pick. I know I'm being sacrilegious here, but... this is going to be challenging. It's going to be ballsy. It's going to be different. And it already fits in the world of the Jungle Book, sort of, is a live-action version of Bambi. What? Live?
Didn't The Rock do that on Saturday Night Live?
Well, hang on.
He did.
This is totally far out. I know this is totally far out, but you got to be daring. You got to be different. This would be so different from the animated movie, and it already exists in a forest, in a jungle, so you're already sort of in that world anyway. No dialogue, real animals. Again, you don't need... Again,
so like WALL-E style.
Very much like WALL-E, but with real animals. You don't need dialogue to tell a coming-of-age story about Bambi standing up on her 4 feet and becoming coming into her own.
Bambi is a boy.
His own. Thank you. His own. Sorry. I totally lost my train of thought here. Thank you. But coming into his own and standing on his own 4 feet, and it's a great coming-of-age story. And it's about friendship, and it's about survival, and it's about being a born leader. And again, you do it all without dialogue.
And we still kill the mother in the beginning.
Absolutely. Got to kill the mother.
All right.
Got to kill the mother. You don't need dialogue to tell the story of Bambi.
John, what's your pick?
Okay. I think these are both great choices. I'm a little confused where Scott... I'm a little confused that Scott says ballsy about Bambi. It's a pretty typical film, and we've seen a numerous talking animal movies, or even if you don't have dialogue, there's still animals inferring dialogue in their communications, in their interest, how you train them, and the things. What you were talking about, Be Yourself, every Disney film is about being yourself.
That was, so not Little Mermaid.
Aladdin wouldn't, well, yes it is, actually.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is, because she's, well, she, am I allowed to make my argument, and then we'll...
We'll come back to that maybe.
Anyway, my choice is The Little Mermaid, and the reason is because I think it's a beautiful film. It's the film that reestablished Disney in the animated world again after they'd kind of lost their way after Fox and the Hound, and I think it's a story that goes all the way deep, and you've got two different kingdoms, so two different worlds for you to explore. Underneath with were King Neptune, and then you have all the little fishes, all those
Triton.
Things. Can say my argument? Hold on, Kim, you'll get to it. And then you'll do all that kind of stuff, and then you have the surface world, which is a little more judgmental. You can deal with class hierarchy. The classism. There's a lot that goes on in this film that a lot of people don't talk about that they explore, and it's kind of actually a very ballsy Disney film explore these kinds of legitimately
word.
Ballsy. They explore these kinds of themes and explore these kinds of things because she wants to be, Ariel wants to be human, to conform to what she thinks is love. But in fact, she realizes at the end, being herself, letting him be himself, then that's true love, not changing yourself to fit your partner or what your partner wants. And I think that's an important message now that needs to be told to kids now. It needs to be told to people still sometimes who get into these relationships and they feel they have to change who they are at the core. And I think Little Mermaid would do a great job of exploring it. Plus, you get the magic of those worlds and the kingdoms and all that kind of stuff. It'd be beautiful.
Kim, I think you want to respond.
She absolutely changed who she was. She lost her father, mm-hmm. her sisters, mm-hmm. all her friends. She decided mm-hmm. to no longer be who she was to suit this man mm-hmm. for a man. Mm-hmm. I don't want to teach that lesson.
That isn't what. Oh, and that doesn't happen in Aladdin.
No.
That doesn't happen.
Well,
he doesn't change who he is
lesson.
For a woman.
But remember,
he changes who he is for a woman.
He
pretends he's a man for a woman.
Jasmine knows he's
What's
poor.
The difference? It
she
goes both ways.
She chooses him anyway.
No, but so and so does the prince with
she's got human legs, not fish legs.
Well, yeah. Well, she has a tail. And then
right.
She gets human legs is what I was trying to say. Did I say fish legs? Sorry.
Well, no, I said fish legs.
Oh, okay.
She does change.
She does. Yeah, they both change.
But
they
re-embrace. He goes to who he is at the end.
Right, but sometimes
that
you
is
have
his
to.
Journey,
you, sometimes you have to leave your family to get to who you want to be. She didn't want to be controlled by her dad, by a man. She didn't want to be controlled by a man. She wanted to find her own way in the world, and Little Mermaid does that. Yes, sometimes she has to leave her controlling father.
That's
some fathers
not what
are
it's
controlling,
about.
But that is
she
to my interpretation. That's
know,
what about?
Do you know
she
who burned. Changes her? Her yeah. father. He uses his magic powers to change her. To be with this guy.
Right, but she comes
she
into
needed
her
him the
own.
Whole time. She didn't do it herself.
She did with Ursula. She
did it
through
for
Ursula.
Her.
And she
Eric
fought through
killed
all that
Ursula.
Stuff. But she fought through
Eric
all that.
Eric killed Ursula.
Right,
she
eventually.
Didn't do it.
I didn't say she killed Ursula. I just said that she took it upon herself to go against all these things and find what she wanted and find her
all
way.
She wanted.
And I think in the end, she comes around and she is a stronger person.
She's not
for
the
it.
Hero of her own movie.
I think she's right. absolutely
all
the
right.
hero of her
all
own
right.
movie.
All right. We're not going to agree on this, I can just assume. But I hear both points. That aside. Why is The Little Mermaid and Bambi not the right choice? Kim.
I kind of like Bambi, but I don't think it would fit into the universe. And I feel the same about The Little Mermaid. We're talking about the Jungle Book universe, which is adventure, about growing up and learning things and becoming
yourself. That's what
Bambi
is.
Yeah. That's also what Little Mermaid is. A lot of adventure, leaving Neptune.
But do you have a tiger in both?
No, oh, Jesus.
You can have a tiger in Bambi.
You can have
a
tiger in Aladdin.
Tiger
I mean,
Bambi.
In Little Mermaid.
And that's how Bambi dies.
But, okay, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No.
Okay, listen, you know, ballsy, you used that word ballsy. Yeah. I say ballsy for Bambi because it would be very easy to do a live-action version of Bambi with talking animals. It would be more daring to do a live-action version of Bambi and just let the actions speak for themselves. And you could do that. And you brought up Wally. I was going to mention that anyway, but that the second half of Wally had dialogue. But to do the whole movie without the dialogue and just
so it's basically
it so
a Disney
pure,
nature movie.
It's a Disney
which they've done. I'm not saying it's a knock, but they've done those successfully
with a narrative structure. With a narrative structure. You were still telling a story. You were still telling a coming-of-age story. You're still telling a movie about survival, about friendship, about growing up and standing on your own 4 feet.
Well, I think that's a great point. However, I think we've seen enough of animal movies. And what he was saying, those are Disney nature movies. Those usually go straight to video. It's the rare ones
no,
that
they
go
come out
over,
on Earth Day.
That too. It's the rare ones that actually cross over. And I mean,
have narrative structure, don't they? It's like usually the monkeys saving the mom, and there's a story on those.
Which ones?
The Earth Day Disney nature movies.
Yeah, I have to look.
They do
that.
Have narrative structure. Absolutely.
Monkey Kingdom was the last one.
Yeah, but I think what you get with Bambi, we've already seen it. We've already seen that story of finding your own two feet. She's arguing.
A Little Mermaid.
But I think
already seen all three of these movies.
Yes,
so.
We have. Was it
and these talking? I mean, Golden Compass. Golden Compass. Anyone? I don't think we need to see any more movies with like animals communicating and all this kind of jazz. I think we've done that thing. I think
just underwater.
With Little Mermaid. I think we've got something more. Those are fish. It's a different situation.
Well,
it's really rare to see fish talking in films. So I think that's a positive.
Your movie is one of my favorite Disney movies. Yep. I love it. I get it. Why? How does it connect to the universe? And why is? And then I'm going to go to all of you. Why does it connect to the universe? And what's the live action?
Well, I think
twist,
just
make it better.
Just like with Jungle Book, you have
fun. Let's not say better, but it makes it interesting.
Sure. Just like with Jungle Book, you have Ariel going out of her comfort zone into this world to try and see if she can fit into this world and be a part of this world. And she's fighting against what the evil of Ursula. She's fighting against, which is I forget the snake's name in Jungle Book, but you have that
Ka.
You have all that there. But then you have her coming into her own as a woman, fighting against her dad, her possessive father. Going out on her own, taking her adventures, taking her hits. Yeah, because as a person, that's what you do. You go through these things, you make mistakes, you trust the wrong people, you go after what you want. But in the end,
she's
a teenager, right? And so she's coming into her own as a woman, as a person, as a young adult, and she has to take the hits so she can learn. And in the end, I think what she does is discover love, and she discovers love on her terms and on his terms. And I think that's what true relationships are about, is compromise.
Kim.
Ariel is so deeply defined by the people around her as opposed to herself as a fully actualized person. Mm-hmm. I'm looking at Aladdin. He starts as nothing. He is he's literally like homeless, living on the street. He's riffraff, street rat. You know what? I don't buy that. There is more inside of him, and he proves that throughout the film as a hero who uses his wits and his cunning and his charm and to save everyone. And he also learns his own lesson about, you know what, I was good enough inside. I didn't have to pretend to be this rich guy. I didn't have to do this because she loves me anyway, and I was able to save the whole kingdom. And I like the message of where it takes him in the end.
And I don't think we're ready, though, for him. I'm sorry. I don't think we're ready for Robin Williams. I don't think we're ready for another Robin Williams genie. I don't.
It's not a Robin Williams genie.
Well, that's the thing.
Both Aladdin and Little Mermaid. I love both of these movies. I mean, like we said about Little Mermaid, like resurrecting Disney, you know, Katzenberg. I mean, that was definitely something that needed to happen. But it became like just part of a conventional model that all the other Disney animated movies followed this. Now, having said that, I feel like Bambi goes back to the basics. It's one of the earlier Disney animated movies, and it has a classic, timeless structure. And it is different from Aladdin, different from Little Mermaid. And to do it without dialogue, it's already set into the wild. So it already fits in the world of the Jungle Book. And it is a classic story. It is a story, and it is a story that is for grown-ups and for kids.
But then it becomes repetitive because we're going back to the jungle.
Well, so with yours.
No, not Little Mermaid. You have the sea, and that's a whole new world that they can explore, and then
Speaking
come out
of a whole
into
new
the
world.
But if you're in the sea, you're not really in that universe, and you're in the jungle, I think we need something different,
and something different from the jungle.
So to clarify again, the question is: if they're in the same universe, the animals in the Jungle Book talk.
Yeah.
So are these just animals deciding not to talk? Or I'm just
because the animals
in every other movie talk, and Bambi talks too. So I'm just trying to understand. Yeah. Are we taking a creative choice?
This is a creative choice just to do something different. And even if the animals don't talk, it could still fit in that world because, I mean, not every animal needs to talk. And I think it would be more of a daring, challenging film and a more engaging one. Because a lot of people, again, going back to the Wall-E argument, a lot of people were impressed and bowled over by the first half of the movie because it didn't have dialogue.
Film,
but it was still made its choice. Okay.
I made a choice. None of you really connected it to the Jungle Book universe, so I'm sort of discrediting all of that for that reason and going strictly off of which movie makes more sense. And Dan, before I make a ruling, any thoughts?
Yeah, that's geographic issues.
I'm sort of discrediting it because I don't think any of them really made points as to how we connect to Jungle Book.
John, I think John at one point.
Yes, you did.
Tiger.
John at one point referenced Neptune. It's Triton.
Oh, Triton. Sorry.
Little Mermaid. The Disney nature. They're narrated documentaries, so they're kind of they have structure, and you can get a 2 p.m. ticket on Saturday to see Aladdin on Broadway for $63. But
that's
one-day
a
pass
deal.
To California Adventure is $99.
But
I have
an annual pass, so the savings over time.
Over time. But you could there,
still
you
fly
could
there.
See Aladdin cheaper.
Yeah, you still got to fly there. Though.
Well, yeah. But listen, I can only do so much research.
This one's tough. Legitimately tough. Because I feel like you two picked very similar movies in that they're very fun, world-building, big things. But you didn't connect it to Jungle Book for me. You also didn't connect it to Jungle Book, but you took a chance and created something interesting. And for that reason alone, I'm giving it to Bambi.
Damn,
I think you took a more daring choice, and I think they played it safe a little bit. And I'm going to go with Mance for taking the chance.
Yay. Hooray, Bambi.
You just wanted to rhyme.
Mance for taking the chance.
Mance taking the chance. That puts us up with Scott with 3 points, Kim with 2 points, John with one. But, man, John, you brought the passion. Thank you for playing hard. They'll either love you or hate you for that, but I please don't hate him because he plays hard. It's hard to come in here. I love the passion. When I do it too, you gotta get frustrated, right?
It's
you just want to win this.
It's all about passion.
I love movies.
We all do.
Yeah.
No, thank
that's
you.
That's where we agree.
That's why we're good. Yeah.
Yes.
All right. Now it's time for speed round.
Speed round.
We tested this with our players earlier. Kim.
I'm dreading this.
Movie Mance, you guys are ready. You know how this works, correct? We're looking for fast, quick answers, short follow-ups, 15 seconds each, and then 5-second follow-ups. If either question you both say the same answer, whoever said it first gets to pick that answer, and then they'll have to pick something else immediately after that. Any questions before we begin the speed round?
Let's go. Let's do this.
I can't talk as fast as you.
Now, to make this interesting, Chris, I'm activating you to help me here. You're going to have some say in this.
Done.
Dan, I may still activate you. We'll see how it plays, but let's have Chris stand in for you for a minute, if you don't mind, because he's here.
I'll be here.
And Kim, I may rely to you to help. I'm sorry, I mean John. May rely to you to help me make the decision.
Sure.
Again, we're listening to the arguments, guys. Make sense? All right. First up. Both of these movies are in the bargain bin. Which should I buy? Transformers 4 or Indiana Jones 4?
Indiana Jones 4.
Oh, no.
Arguing for Indiana Jones 4 will be Scott. Arguing for Transformers 4 will will be Kim.
This is going to be good.
Time on the clock, Scott.
Indiana.
Ready? Go.
Indiana Jones 4 is my least favorite of the Indiana Jones movies, but it still has its merits. Once you take out Shia LaBeouf, I still think it is a worthy progression of the Indiana Jones character. How does Indiana Jones fit in an atomic world? Harrison Ford, it was just great to see him back in Indiana Jones. There you go.
Got it. Kim, are you ready? I think she's just verifying something, which I'm going to allow, but your time starts.
I got it.
Ready. Action. Transformers 4, 15 seconds, go.
All right, this one does not have Shia LaBeouf, so there's that going for it right away. Mark Wahlberg joins. Isn't he a great action hero? Also, Peter Cullen as Optimus Prime. He's amazing. He is a national treasure, and who doesn't love robots?
All right, Scott, 5 second rebuttal.
Indiana Jones has Kate Blanchett, and she's an Oscar winner, but Transformers 4 is unwatchable. It should be a spoof.
5 second rebuttal.
Nuke the fridge. That's it.
All right. Chris, what do you think based on the arguments? Who are you going to pick?
I got to go with Mance.
Mance. What? John, based on the arguments.
I actually got to go with Kim with the nuke the fridge comment. That was a good comment.
She brought that back.
She did.
I wish you would have explained a little bit why, or swinging with monkeys. So it was very close, but I think Mance pulled it a closer.
He argued better, to be fair.
It was an argue better. I got to give it to Mance.
Give it up.
Wow. But that was close.
I didn't
want to
defend this movie.
You did well, though. You were close there. All right. This is a broad one. It's a creative one. Ready? Who would be the best director for the remake of the movie? We're making this up. If we remade the movie blank, I'm going to tell you in a second, who would be the best director? And the movie is Waterworld.
David Fincher.
Okay. What? David Fincher's Waterworld. Kim, you have a few seconds. Who would you pick?
Who directed the last Fast and Furious movie?
James Wan.
Him.
Okay. Great. And Fincher, Mance on the clock, 15 seconds. Tell me when you're ready, Dan.
I'm ready.
Go.
If you're going to go post-apocalyptic, you're going to make it dark. Dark is what Fincher is all about, but he also makes very entertaining movies. This would have a stylish look, and it would have just be gritty. It would be a lot at stake. You would feel the realism of this film. It would not be cheesy, and it would not be mindless.
Kim.
James Wan has worked with some not great premises and not great scripts and turned them into fantastic movies, such as the previous Fast and Furious movie. He can definitely handle the action that is required for this. The reason why that this stayed a show at Universal Studios, despite being a garbage movie.
5 seconds?
Okay, I gotta say that James Wan would just make Waterworld look just like the 1995 version of Waterworld.
Kim, 5 seconds?
I mean, when are there going to be lawyers in Waterworld? I don't understand how this is going to go. It's kind of not the right guy.
Lawyers?
Isn't it? Wait. Politicians? Nope. I've messed this up.
Yeah.
Yeah, you lost me.
Yeah.
Kevin Costner in the
Costner
water?
Waterworld?
Kevin Reynolds directed Waterworld.
Yes.
Is that right? Yeah. 1995?
All right. right? John, thoughts on the arguments?
Definitely Mance.
Mance, Chris.
Mance, but I'm surprised nobody said George Miller.
Yeah, yeah. I was thinking that myself.
Yeah, he would have been good, brother.
George Miller would have been a good one. That's two. I would have picked a two. Mance, you're back on the board, I think. She has to win.
Kim has to run the table to force a tie.
You need all three of these to force a tie, Kim. It's been done.
Wait, I have to do three more of these?
Or one more and you're done.
All right. Guess where I'm going.
Both of these graphic novels are playing on cable. Which one should we watch? Watchmen or Sin City?
Watchmen.
I think I heard Mance first.
Slight edge
to Watchmen for Mance. That means Sin City. You have a minute. You have a second to think while Mance starts.
Watchmen.
Go.
Watchmen is the Citizen Kane of comic book movies. Underrated film. There's so much depth to it. It is so ambitious. It is a movie that deserves repeated viewings, which is why watching it time and time again, you will get something more out of it. A lot of characters. A lot at stake.
Watchmen was not the best execution of one of arguably the best graphic novels of all time. Sin City, it's visually beautiful. We have it's very, very interesting to watch, which I think gives it a leg up at that point, at least.
5 second rebuttal.
Sin City is cheese. It looks good, but it peters out fast. Watchmen holds up.
Watchmen misses the point of why this comic was created in the first place and the message that it creates.
Whoa, all right. I'm going to show my cards. I'm going with Kim on that one. Yeah. I think she did pull it. Chris?
Last comment, Kim.
Really did it. John, absolutely, you in the same boat? All right, comment. Kim, you're still in this.
Yay.
The Citizen Kane comic.
Yes,
it is.
A lot of head rolling.
It is.
There.
Watchmen, it is it's so layered. Nope. There's so much depth to it.
Everyone in the booth, they were not agreeing with you.
But not digging. Oh, man. No. Bad choice, Mance.
Not even.
All right, here we go. This one. Best movie with the word game or games in the title.
The game.
Hunger Games.
Hunger Games versus the game. Wow, okay. Hunger Games 1 is what I'm going to say.
First one.
Yes, great. Hunger Games 1, and I heard the game first, so you get a moment, Kim, and let's start the clock. 15 seconds for the game.
Well, David Fincher, one of his more underrated films, but it's still a worthy film. You don't know where it's going. Great performance from Michael Douglas. Great twist ending with Sean Penn. Gritty, the cinematography, the direction, the intensity. It's a perfect film that not enough people have seen.
All right, 15 seconds on the clock for Hunger Games. Go ahead, Kim.
This is where we got to see Jennifer Lawrence really, well, we've seen her before deliver a great performance, but here we saw her in a different kind of role, and no one else could have made that character come to life the way she did. And this invented a craze. We are all going after the post-apocalyptic genre now because of how well this movie did.
5 second rebuttal, Scott.
Hunger Games, based on a book, you know where it's going to go. The game, you didn't know where it was going to go. Unpredictable from start to finish.
It doesn't have to follow the book, and it is a little bit different. It does take certain liberties, and I think these choices were good overall in getting the message across about fascism.
All right, Chris, I'm putting you on the heat based on the arguments. Who are you going to go with?
Cocaine Donkey.
John.
Yeah, this was tough. I have to go with Mance on this one, yeah.
You were close. I think you could have gotten a little bit further on Hunger Games, and I think you crushed it in your last little closing game wins. That means Scott wins the game!
Mance and Mance. Give it up,
buddy. Wow, Kim, high five. You really did a great job. That was a great debut fight. John as well, fantastic play. Thank you guys so much for coming. Wow, congratulations, Scott. That's Thanks. Two for you in a row.
Take that.
Who knows? Well
take
deserved.
That, take that asterisk off the board next to Scott's wins. Yeah. It's now official.
What?
Wait, can I just say, I love you, man.
I love you,
this
man.
This was fun.
You guys brought some heat. I mean, and
heat,
you
baby.
Got to sit back and.
1995, Michael Mann.
I got
to
say.
You got to snipe them as they punched each other. It was a pretty good fight, I got to say. Wow. Thank you guys so much. As always, you know, we're on iTunes. If you didn't, please go subscribe to us there. T-shirt store at districtlines.com/screenjunkies. I just want to thank each of you so much. Ox Hollywood. Scott Mance, let's plug. What do you got to plug? Your Twitter,
okay.
Movie Mance on Twitter.
Please follow me at Movie Mance. And yes, you can catch me on Access Hollywood. But this is crucial. Our show Profiles, which I host and produce with 4-time Movie Fights champion Alicia Malone.
Such a great show.
We need people to watch this show. It's on the Popcorn Talk Network. It's called Profiles with Malone and Mance. But definitely, if you like our Facebook page, which is Profiles with Malone and Mance, you'll see what we're all about. So please like our Facebook page. And big announcement. This coming Monday, we're profiling Sigourney Weaver at 6 p.m. Pacific time. If you watch it live, guess who was calling in to talk about Sigourney Weaver? None other than James Cameron himself.
Wow, nice. That's a score.
That's a huge. Big get. We're very proud.
Wow, congrats. When is that, Monday at 6?
Monday at 6 p.m.
Pacific
time.
Okay.
Yes.
Facebook page, Profiles with Malone and Mance. Please go support that. We want to support you guys. We love that show.
Thank you.
You deserve it. That's a great get. Awesome score. John Rocha at The Rocha Says. Anything you'd like to plug?
Yeah, I host the Cast of Characters, which is a new podcast about voiceover animation. And we're hosting that on Geek Nation. Yuri Lowenthal, who many of you know.
Oh, he's wonderful.
He's my co-host. And we've had Phil Lamar, John DiMaggio. We had Roger Craig Smith. And this past episode was Josh Keaton, who was the voice of Spider-Man and Green Lantern. So that's
Ooh,
great.
That's
one that
awesome.
We've got. And we have the Top 10 show on the YouTube Podcast Network, which I host with Matt Nost and Far Far Away, of course, on Geek Nation with Tiffany Smith. You can follow me on Instagram or Twitter at The Rocha Says. I'm slowly building a little thing.
Good work. Good work, brother. Keep it up. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Andy.
And Kim Horcher, where can people find you? Anything you'd like to say at Kim Horcher?
No, it's at Kim Scorcher.
Oh, Kim Scorcher.
There's a long story behind that. I didn't make the name, okay? Someone
That's
did
awesome.
It for me. But I am Kim Horcher on Instagram, which is what I chose myself. My show is called Nerd Alert. It is part of the Young Turks Network, and it is a talk show. A real talk show. So there's some realness, there's some opinions, there's some F-bombs. I mean, it happens. But it's on a variety of different topics. So I will talk about movies, but I will also talk about video games. I will also talk about science fiction, fantasy, science fact, futurism. It's a great variety of topics. I am the creator and main host. And
where can we find it?
YouTube.com/nerdalert.
Nerd alert.
Love it.
Go. I'm going.
Congrats. Awesome work, all three of you. On the couch, I got to thank him as always, Mr. Dan Merle.
Yes,
Dan.
We trucked through this episode.
@MerleDan on Twitter. One last correction for Scott. Alicia may be a four-time winner, but there's only one Movie Fights champion.
Hey, you, buddy. That's you. Okay. Stay correct.
Next to you, I'd like to thank Chris Zimmerman at Zimma Bim Bim on Twitter and Magnificent 7 Podcast Guys. Please check it out. Where can they find it? On your Twitter, I imagine. Anywhere else?
Yeah, it's on iTunes, Android, and a new segment that just launched today called Movie Zagats.
Ooh,
and that's
I like that.
It's a lot of fun.
Listen to that nice voice of his, right? It's an easy voice to listen to for an hour.
It is.
And us Screen Junkies have been, you've been very generous at getting us on there early. You were one of the first ones to get us all, so we all have been supporting it, so thank you for watching us, and thank you for doing that. Did you have fun?
Yes.
Woohoo! All right. I'm glad you could join us.
So fun.
Please follow me on Twitter and Instagram at Andy Signor. Tell us what you like. Tell us what you didn't like. Tell me I suck. I don't care. It's all good to me. But I'm so grateful for all of you for watching. I want to thank you guys one last time. Awesome fight. Woo! Really good fight.
Yeah.
Have a wonderful Sunday, everybody. See you later.
Bye.
Bye.
Every podcast we put on YouTube comes with this kick-ass graphic listing all the topics your favorite Screen Junkies podcasters are talking about. If you click the topics, you can skip around and choose your own podcast battle royale. Go ahead, try them all. If you haven't already, subscribe to Screen Junkies on YouTube to join us for future fights. Or if you prefer to listen on iTunes, click the logo to download an audio version.